morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Sheffield. We're glad that we can be together here this morning. I want to refer to you a few of the announcements on the bulletin. If you would look on page 5 of the bulletin. Just a reminder once again that there's a meeting of Rockton and Sheffield congregations next Sunday over in Rockton at 11 o'clock. There's no service here next Sunday. That's to receive and deliberate upon the recommendations of the Joint Needs Assessment Committee. If you need a copy of the Jane Act report and haven't got one yet, there are some copies on the window ledge at the back of the sanctuary. And in preparation for next Sunday, there is going to be an information session after church this morning. Now, Dave, can you tell me how that's supposed to take place? Or
I think we'll just chair it up here.
So you're going to do that immediately after worship?
Yes.
Okay. So everybody stay. We're going to have the information time after church, and then there'll be some coffee and goodies and such downstairs for us to enjoy. For those of you who haven't heard yet, and probably a number of you have, Dorothy Rehan fell the other day and broke her wrist. That was on Tuesday or Wednesday. She's doing fine, Susan Mackay reports, but if you would like to send her a card or send greetings, if you would see Susan after church, she'll give you the address of Queen Square, Paris, which is 10 Melville in Cambridge, but she'll fit you in more fully than that. Do any of you ever listen to a CBC program called The Debaters? It's a good comedy program, right? Did you hear them the other day? They were talking about boredom.
I heard it yesterday.
And one comedian was on the side of boredom, and the other one wasn't. And it made me think about when our children were younger, they were not allowed to use the word bored. I didn't like to hear them say, "I'm bored," because there's always something to do in my view. Well, this one comedian said the other day that if your child says, "I'm bored," it's not a statement, it's a threat. Because it means if you don't come up with something pretty quickly, whatever I come up with is going to be a whole lot more interesting and exciting. I thought it was quite true to the case. Are there birthdays to be celebrated? None this morning? Are there anniversaries to be celebrated? Joan?
We're going to play Mars on Wednesday.
You're going to, and how many is that going to be?
59 years.
59 on Wednesday. Please pass on our regards to Les, and you have a great day on Thursday. Thank you. Marilyn and Janice, I believe, are going to lead us in our opening this morning.
Jesus, the living water of life. The peace and grace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Come in. Come into this holy place, which we make special by our being here together.
Come into this place where we are here sanctified, the human is celebrated, and all are welcome.
voting in. Come in and sit down. Hymn number 395, and it was together.
Child of God, I am under the sound of God.
Good morning. How are you? Fabulous. What exciting things did you do this week? How would you like to drive on that road? Would that feel risky? Anybody know where it is? It's in Coventry, England.
Can I help you with a commentary? We're just short of a town, aren't we? What do you reckon that drop?
Now I've got to stop, and I've got to go on to about there. Now
the roof rack's going to get stuck under the air rack, so Rick is going to go ahead and scope out the height so we can get through with the van. It's a narrowest piece of road we've been down. The drop to the river is estimate 2,000 feet. It's just complete. I'm going to reckon wrong.
Scenery beautiful, eh?
Thank you.
she's got a sheet, you can talk to her.
I did not even like drive you through the Rockies.
I just thought that was, wow. I don't know why they built that road or how long it's been. It's probably just as safe as the Downing Road in Guelph, probably. But it don't look that way, does it? So, you know, there's always risks in life, right? Always some kind of risk, whether it's a cat fight or whether you're on the other side of the pool or whatever we've got to do. So, we have to decide whether we want to take the risk or not. I guess that's one of the things we have to do. Let's have a prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thanks for coming. Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked him, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you, but from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. And for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. And therefore, God, what God has joined together, let no one separate. In Deuteronomy it says, suppose a man enters into a marriage with a woman, but she does not please him, because he finds something objectionable about her. And so he writes her a certificate of divorce, puts it in her hand, and sends her out of the house. She then leaves his house and goes off to become another man's wife. Now then, suppose the second man dislikes her. He writes her a bill of divorce, puts it in her hand, and sends her out of his house. Or the second man who married her dies. The first husband who sent her away is not permitted to take her again to be his wife after she has been defiled, for that would be abhorrent to the Lord, and you shall not bring guilt on the land that your Lord God is giving you as a possession. I love this next part. When a man is newly married, he shall not go out with the army or be charged with any related duty. He shall be free at home for 1 year to be happy with the wife whom he has married. That's nice. This morning we have our third topic in our series, How My Mind Has Changed About, and this topic was generated by two replies to my invitation to send in comments. Here's the first. I guess over the years I've changed my mind somewhat about divorce and the consequences of it upon the spouses, children, and other family members. When I was young, divorce wasn't as common as it is now, and it was truly frowned upon. Couples carried on no matter what. We have been blessed with a very happy marriage, so it's sometimes hard to understand what others go through or live with. However, after seeing other people in very unhappy situations, I've come to the belief that as much as one promised to cherish the other until death do they part, sometimes untenable situations enter the picture and it becomes impossible to cherish or be cherished. And in that case, divorce now seems to be an acceptable solution and allows everyone to move forward. As one of our friends said when his daughter with a 2-year-old separated from her husband, life is too short to be unhappy. When our daughter told us she was separating from her husband, we were shocked, as she had been very careful to hide her hurt and her disappointment from us. We had known that the situation was not always the best, but she was the mother of 2 young children, and now she would be on her own. I realize there are things I cannot change. What I can do is always be there to offer love and support, and that's our role as parents, to stand behind her and help wherever needed. Now, many of us can identify fully with those thoughts, as many of us have experienced marriage breakdown within our own families. The writer is eminently correct in saying that there are consequences not only for the two people involved, but for others as well. Children, regularly pay a big price. For extended families, it often means that you have little or perhaps no contact with someone who was a part of your family for many, many years. Friends have to shift gears too, because it's always tricky and sometimes it's impossible to remain good friends with both partners with whom you used to spend a lot of time together. The parents of the two who have separated, they can only do as parents always do. They continue to love as best they can. They support as best they can. And they stand by and be ready to pitch in wherever help is needed. Now that we've heard things from a parent's perspective, listen to these comments from one whose own marriage fell apart. Over the course of 4 years, my marriage fell apart and finally ended. Throughout the experience, I learned a number of things. Predominantly, I learned that sometimes love isn't enough. You can love some with everything you've got, and even then, your love can be rejected. You can leave to try to communicate how tenuous things have become. You can try anything and everything you know of to try and get things moving towards a more positive, healthy outcome, but to no avail. You can beg the other person to seek professional help. You can offer to go with them if they'll agree to go even once. But the plea is resisted. Accepting that you can't help someone until they're truly open to being helped, it's a hard lesson for me to learn. Truthfully, I came very close to losing myself in the process. Abuse is an ugly word, and not one I would have ever thought would be part of my world. And yet there I was, living a statistic as an abused spouse. Too ashamed to ask for help myself, and completely worn out by the effort it was taking me to keep my reality a secret from others who cared the most about me. The irony here is that without the love I received from my family, my friends, my faith community, while continuing to do the things I love and care about, I'm almost certain I would not have made it out the other side. So even though love wasn't enough in my marriage, it ended up being more than enough in my wider circle. In fact, it's what helped fuel the courage I needed to finally, with humility, admit that things weren't going to change and that I needed to save myself. While it can be hard sometimes, I've always believed that things happen for a reason. Often we don't understand what those reasons are in the moment, which can be frustrating. But all the time I was picking up the pieces, I tried to keep in mind what God was trying to tell me if I would only listen more closely. That belief kept me going, even when I didn't think I had another step in me. It's been a painful journey, but I have learned a great deal about myself and abusive relationships and why it's so hard to walk away, even when you know it's the right thing for everyone involved. It is my sincere hope that knowledge and my humility will serve not only myself, but others that I touch going forward. And that's a tough and touching personal story. What do? When you've tried and tried and tried, but nothing has worked. Our first writer included the lines, "Life is too short to be unhappy." And perhaps that's the learning in the second story as well. Now look, This is heavy stuff. So to lighten the mood a little, let me share with you a couple of humorous quotes about marriage. The first comes from Rita Rudner, an American comedian, writer, and actress who once said, "I love being married. It's so great to find that one special person that you want to annoy for the rest of your life." Any candidates? The late Katharine Hepburn, who was a leading Hollywood film star for more than 50 years, once said, "Sometimes I wonder if men and women really suit each other. Perhaps they should just live next door and go visit now and then." Incidentally, this is something I discovered in checking out some stuff about Katharine Hepburn. In contrast to many Hollywood personalities, she was only married once. In 1928, when she was only 21, she married a businessman named Ludlow Ogden Smith. She made him change his name to S. Ogden Ludlow so that she would not be saddled with the name Kate Smith, which she considered too plain. But in spite of the name change, that marriage only lasted for 4 years, and she never ever did remarry. On a more sobering, reflective note, Mark Twain once said this of marriage: "Marriage is the supreme happiness of life, and it's also the supreme tragedy of life." When marriages are happy, there's little that gives people more fulfillment. But when marriages end, whether necessary a lot or not, there's always a lot of pain, and sometimes bordering on tragedy. During the course of my career in ministry, I have conducted many weddings. I'm not sure exactly how many, somewhere in excess of 1,000, well over that. And somewhere along the line, I realized that I had absolutely no way of predicting whether or not a marriage would last. I would say to myself, if there's ever a solid marriage in the making, there it is. Those two have everything going for them. 2 years later, I learned they have separated. Or I would shake my head and think, I do not believe I have ever seen two people less suited for each other. If this marriage lasts, it will take some kind of miracle. And 5 years later, 10 years later, maybe more, they're still going strong. They've worked at it, and they've made it work. And that's what it takes, constant work. Determination, willingness to compromise, direct communication, listening as well as talking, more listening than talking. Doing whatever is needed to make the relationship mutually satisfying, taking care of each other, being willing to make sacrifices for the good of the cause rather than centering only on one's own interests and desires. And being willing to deal with whatever it is that is causing stress in the relationship. But sometimes, far too many times actually, marriages fail. The federal government has decided to prohibit Statistics Canada from gathering personal data that's relevant anymore, so it's now impossible to get accurate statistics about marriage failure. But the latest available from 2008 was that 43% of marriages end in divorce before couples reach their 50th anniversary. And that was up roughly 40% from 10 years prior. They fail for a lot of reasons. Health issues of one of the partners, the loss of a job which causes financial stress, career complications, the introduction of a third party, keeping grudges over something that happened years before, abuse, and abuse comes in several forms. It can be physical, but it can also be psychological, which can be just as damaging. Time was, as the first writer pointed out, that divorce was truly frowned upon. People stayed together no matter what. I think I may have told you about the woman who came to see me one time, a woman in her early 70s, and she said, "This morning my husband got angry again and walked out, and he said he would never be back. He's done that more times than I can count, and this time I finally hope he doesn't come back. We have been married 53 years. The day after we got married, I knew it was the worst mistake I would ever make in my life. But she had stayed." So time was when people stayed together in spite of. And part of the reason was that in earlier times, women didn't have the options they have now. They had to stay in intolerable relationships because there was nothing else they could do. And thankfully, that has changed. Now, I don't want you to go home saying, dear, I'm packing my things, I might have. And when you're asked, what, why, you answer, a preacher said it's okay. So a word of caution, don't go making up stuff. Don't misinterpret what I'm saying. I'm not saying that everybody should just up and leave their marriages, but there are times when marriages need to end. Even then, you don't do it with a whole lot of work and a whole lot of thought. There are passages in the Bible which at first blush seem to prohibit divorce. An example is this morning's reading from Mark, which ends with these words, "Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." And there are others. The interesting thing to consider is that in this case of the reading from Mark and also from the one from Deuteronomy, it's only the woman who isn't permitted divorce. The man can do whatever he wishes. Wife doesn't please him, give her a certificate and send her back. She marries again, the second guy doesn't like her any better, she's gone again. In those days, a woman was a man's property, just the same as his plot of ground that was marked out by a bunch of stones. In the case of marriage and divorce, as with all other things in life, we need to remember that the Bible comes from a different time and conveys understandings from that time. It is not meant to be a rule book for all times to come. Marrying and living happily ever after is certainly the ideal, but sometimes the ideal is impossible, and then there's the ending. With respect to endings, I appreciate these following words that I read recently that were written by Robert Fulgen. There's no such thing as a happy ending. There's happy, and there's endings. But they aren't concurrent. There's no such things as living happily ever after, either. There's living, and there's happily, and there's ever after. They just don't come at the same time. So, having conceded that in spite of our very best intentions, marriages sometimes end in separation and divorce, let's close with a positive note about what is helpful to consider with respect to marriage. Recently, I read a piece written by people who had just celebrated their 12th anniversary, and the things which follow that I'm going to read include some of the words and some of my own reflections. One, marriage is the final frontier. When you get married, even if you're really ready for it, it's normal to wake up some days and think, holy mackerel, married forever and ever. It's only then you realize what a big commitment marriage really is. It's quite extraordinary, really, to commit the remainder of your life to just one person and never to be taken lightly. Two. Marriage takes you into very intimate territory. There are times in a marriage when you're asked to do things you would never do when you're dating. Things such as evaluating a nose hair, cutting the other person's toenail. But it's also kind of nice to have someone there who will tell you if you have a piece of celery between your teeth and not feel judged by it. Three, little things mean a lot. A good test of whether you should consider living with someone forever is to ask yourself if you could put up with his or her biggest flaw, the worst version of this person, for the rest of your life. Because remember that as people age, their flaws grow ever sharper. If your partner tends to be cranky and stubborn when younger, you can bet your bottom dollar that he or she will only get more so that way as years go on. Learn to live with little annoyances. And remember that in the grand scheme of things, the little everyday acts of kindness, respect, and love are the things that keep a marriage going. The next one. In a good marriage, there's no such thing as just you. There's not me and you, there's us. We're a team. And it takes teamwork to make the team successful. When we don't work together as a team, we're like two horses who just can't drag the wagon out of the mud. Last one. Marriage is a constant work in progress. No matter how long you've been married, you can't relax and depend on the marriage doing well without work. The years jumble together, and if you're not careful, it's far too easily the case that you take the other for granted. As the second writer said in today's topic, love is not by itself is not enough. Even after decades of living together, you still learn things about your partner. Sometimes those things surprise you. Really? You want to take up mountain climbing? You never told me about that before. Or how come you never ever told me that you don't like going to the opera? Marriage is like a dance. You have to keep in rhythm with each other. Stay in step as the music of life changes. And when that happens, it can be a beautiful dance indeed. Amen. A morning offering for you. Thank you. We bring them from ourselves, from the center of our living. We ask that you bless them for use in your service, in the work of this church, our community, and our world. Bless these gifts, us who bring them, and all the other ways in which we give of ourselves. Amen.
Thank you.
Our closing hymn, an old favorite gospel hymn, number 651 in Voices United, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah.
Questions that were on our minds that
that we didn't have a chance to voice, because we are going to have that vote next week, and we wanted everybody to make an informed and a good decision in their mind. So I guess if we have anybody that has any questions or and concerns, Ronnie? Lynn, we're on the joint needs assessment board with myself and Nancy Hall, and we are here to field some questions, if you have any that we can help you with. So if anybody has anything they'd like to say,